The first algorithm that I'll walk through is the end of service determination method, which is integrated into the BQ34110. The end of service determination uses learning pulses to evaluate the health of the battery and try to estimate whether it's nearing the end of its usable life in a backup system. So what this algorithm does is it triggers learning pulses, and it uses those learning pulses to gain data as to what is the status of the battery. These learning pulses are only done very infrequently, generally just after a cell has aged significantly, such as maybe weekly or even monthly. And so what it's doing is it's doing a very small discharge on the system and then analyzing the resistance from that small discharge and looking at the trend of that over time in order to evaluate the status of the battery. And so in order to implement that, we have two options or ways for doing this. One is called charge before discharge learning pulse, and then the other one is a discharge before charge learning pulse. During normal operation of the system, the battery, the system will be powered. You'll have the battery plugged in. It's maintaining fairly a full charge typically. We have a CEDV gauging algorithm, which is used in the part with some slight changes in it. And normally in a backup system, you may charge the battery to a voltage that is slightly below the maximum allowed. For example, in a lithium ion system, you may be allowed to charge at 4.2, but instead maybe you've reduced that to 4.1 or 4.0 just to give a longer life to the system. And the gauging algorithm will then calculate state of charge based on full charge capacity, which it uses in the standard algorithm. Then as part of the end of service determination, which is really a separate module from the gauging, we trigger learning pulses periodically. And these are very controlled discharges with very limited depth. So we're really trying to minimize how much impact we have on the capacity that's available for the backup system. The timing between the pulses is important for some parts of the algorithm. And then as we capture pulses over time, as I said, it may be once a month, it may be once every few weeks, we then process that data and then can calculate the and estimate the end of service of the cell. The learning pulses used by the end of service determination algorithm can be triggered in two different ways. One is based on charge before discharge, and the other one discharge before charge. So in a charge before discharge pulse, this is primarily used in a system where you have a programmable charger so that you can actually change the charging voltage that's used to charge the battery. So the battery may stay, for example, here you can see my mouse. Long term, you may stay charged at a level here, which is a little below the maximum allowed. Say this is 4.0 volts. And then when you when a learning pulse is triggered, the system will then charge to a slightly higher voltage. Say this is 4.2, for example. Terminates charge, and then you have a relaxation period where the cell relaxes, the voltage stabilizes to DC levels, and then we turn on our learning discharge. And here's where we have our controlled discharge that will discharge something on the order of 1 or 2% of capacity over time. And this turns off, and then we relax again so that the voltage stabilizes to very settled level, and then we capture, the gauge itself will capture all the voltage and the current and the temperature throughout this entire operation and use this in the calculations. And so you can see here then that this does not affect your guaranteed backup at all, because normally if you're only charging up to say 4.0 volts here, we're actually overcharging slightly, still in allowed limits, and using the discharge from that overcharge back down to a level that is closer to what you normally have as full charge. So you're not impacting the guaranteed backup capacity available to the system at all in this approach. The other approach is using the discharge before charge learning pulse. This is primarily intended for a system where you do not have a programmable charger. Maybe the charger always will charge to a fixed level, for example, 4.0, 4.1 volts. So in that case, before you have a learning pulse, you will already have the system charged. It will be sitting at the 4.0 volts, for example. And then when we begin the learning pulse, we will first monitor for relaxation, make sure the battery is completely relaxed. Then we will trigger the discharge. And so we'll go through the learning discharge, discharging the 1 or 2-ish percent of capacity, stop that, and then relax again. And then at the end of the relaxation, then we will trigger and can recharge back to the original level that it was charged at the beginning. So in this case, you can use this system with a fixed voltage charger, and you're impacting your guaranteed backup slightly, because normally you would have had this extra little bit of capacity here, 1 or 2% higher, but then with the learning pulse, you're dropping that the 1 or 2% just while you're doing that pulse and then getting back again. The algorithm is using these learning pulses in order to take measurements of the resistance of the battery, and then from that data it uses that to estimate whether the cell is approaching the end of its usable life. So this is kind of a typical profile you can see here. Resistance, which as a cell ages, the resistance of the cell will tend to creep up, and this is a function of time and cycling that occurs, and then over time slowly the resistances will increase somewhat linearly in the early stages and then become super linear after a while, until finally it, when it's really approaching, you know, limited usefulness, the resistance is spiking off quite heavily. So this is what we're actually trying to identify using the algorithm in the BQ34110. So the learning pulses that are triggered are using a discharge level that's on the order of C over 100 to C over 10 for a short time duration. So we're only trying to discharge a limited amount of capacity, typically 1 to 2-ish% or so. And then the device is monitoring the voltage, current, and temperature of the cell during this entire relaxation, during the discharge, and during the post-relaxation again. And then these pulses are triggered periodically, you know, at intervals. It may be once a month, maybe once every few weeks. And from each learning pulse, we calculate a resistance of the cell called an R cell. And we store that in the device, and then we analyze those R cell values and the trend of those values in order to determine then, is the cell approaching the end of its usable life? There are two methods integrated into the device to then trigger an end of service based on that data that's collected. One is called direct resistance decisioning, or DRD, and then the other one is looking at the trend of the resistances over time, which is called resistance slope decisioning, or RSD. The direct resistance decisioning approach looks at each of the R cell values that are calculated, you know, during operation of the device, you know, once a month, once every so many weeks, and it compares those to an initial R cell value that was captured right when the device was first put into operation, when the cell was fresh, you know, and not aged at all. And then based on that comparison, it can decide whether the cell is approaching the end of its life, has it aged significantly or not. And so it's looking at this and continuously comparing it back to what the fresh cell had, and then can provide alerts based on that. So the direct resistance decisioning approach uses the first R cell that is taken right when the cell is first put into service, and so it stores that value in flash memory as the initial R cell value. And then after that, as it is in operation and periodically measuring values of the R cell, then it is comparing those as a ratio of that to the initial R cell, and then comparing those to thresholds that are stored in the part. So there's an alert threshold where if it's less than that, then your normal operation, you assume there's no serious aging. If you pass the alert threshold but are less than a warning threshold, then we can set an alert flag. And then after we pass a warning threshold, we set another warning flag. And so as your age, as the cell ages over time, you know, and over cycles, then you can end up with the resistance. The R cell value generally is increasing steadily. And so then you can get an alert and a warning when it passes the different thresholds. And so then these can be set such that you get some amount of advance notice when the cell is approaching a point to where it really should be replaced. We also have some filtering set up in the device so that you can actually enable the alert to only, or the warning to only be indicated after you get such as multiple readings, you know, rather than if maybe you have a noisy reading and one of them is suddenly above the threshold. So maybe you need 2 or 3 or 4 readings above the threshold before it actually triggers the alert or the warning. The second approach to analyzing the R cell values is the resistance slope decisioning, or RSD approach. And this technique is looking at the slope of the R cell changes versus time. So in this case, it takes multiple R-cell readings, and as the slope increases, it is expecting there to be a somewhat low or linear slope in the early stages of aging, and then as you get more significant aging occurring, then when the slope increases, you can trigger alerts and warnings to the user that the cell is needing replacement. Rather than looking just at the R-cell values directly, the resistant slope decisioning approach looks instead at the R-rate, or the derivative of the R-cell versus time, and makes decisions based on that. So similar to the other approach, it also captures at the very beginning, when the cell is first put into operation, it captures an initial R-rate value. How is the cell resistance changing versus time? And it stores that in flash memory, and it uses that for comparison. And so then later during operation, it is capturing new values of the R rate. And as it captures each new value of the R rate, it is comparing that, you know, as a ratio to the initial R rate value, and comparing that to various thresholds in the part. And so if it's below the alert level threshold, then it assumes, okay, there's no significant aging occurring. After you pass the first threshold, then it'll set an alert flag to alert the system that some moderate aging has occurred. And then after it passes the second threshold, then you end up setting the warning flag, which is intended to indicate that, okay, the cell most likely does need replacement now. And again, just like before, there's also filtering in here, so you can program that we get multiple readings of the R rate above the threshold before it actually triggers the alerts to the system. How the device actually calculates the R rate is very simple. It's taking multiple R cell readings and it's looking at the slope of those. So it will take two R cell readings, R cell 2 minus R cell 1, and then divide that by the time stamp between those two readings, and that calculates the R rate. However, that does bring up a limitation in the device that if you end up triggering learning phases too close in time to each other, then the T2 minus T1 value will be somewhat small, but you also find that the device is not really aged very significantly. And so then the R cell measurements will be very close, limited by, say, noise measurement inaccuracy between the two readings. And so if you actually don't wait a long enough time so that the R cell values have change significantly between each other, you can end up with very erratic results. So because of this, when you're using the resistant slope decisioning, it's recommended that you only trigger the learning phases at fairly long intervals, such that you have some moderate amount of aging that actually occurs, such as once every several weeks or once a month, for example. The algorithm includes flexibility on how the learning pulses are initiated or triggered. You can set it up for automatic operation, where you just program it with a particular time period between the learning pulses. This might be, for example, 1 month, 3 weeks, 6 weeks. Also when it's actually, so when it wakes up and then begins to do a learning pulse, if there's something going on in the system and it needs to abort that, it will recognize that, it will abort, and then it can turn around and retry. And so then there's also another programmable period for when you have a failed or aborted learning sequence, and then when it waits to initiate a new one. For example, maybe a 1 day period. The learning pulses are really only intended to be triggered when the system is quiet. You should not have load current flowing, you know, to the load at the same time as you're trying to do a learning pulse. And so because of that, if you're right in the middle of a learning pulse and suddenly a backup event occurs, a load turns on, some charging occurs that was unexpected, the device will actually detect that and then will abort the learning sequence, the learning pulse, and then we'll turn around, wait the program period of time, and then retry again. The learning pulses can also be triggered manually by host processor, for example, and that's the host controlled initiation. We have a command in the device where the host can just send the command and it will initiate a pulse at that time. And it will then report its status. You know, is it running? Did it complete and pass? Did it fail in the middle? Did it need to abort? And then you can, and if the user sees something else going on and they need to abort it, they can also do that, the host controller. The algorithm also includes some temperature limits on when you actually will trigger a learning pulse, such that if you were outside of a prescribed range, which is set by flash settings in the device, then the learning pulse would be aborted and it would wait and try again later when the temperature is back in an acceptable range. The reason for doing this is because the R cell values, the resistance of the cell, is very dependent on temperature. And so the device is doing temperature compensation based on the readings, since it's comparing a reading now versus a reading a month ago, or a reading back when it was fresh, you know, which may have been a year beforehand, and those readings were captured at different temperatures. And so in order to compare them accurately, it needs to do proper temperature compensation on that. But if you get over too broad of a range of temperature, even the temperature compensation has its limits. And so based on this, you can then decide over what temperature range do you want to allow learning pulses to occur. So ultimately, the real benefit of this EOS algorithm is that you are able to keep a backup battery system online the entire time. The learning process that goes on here is only using the very top, very small amount of capacity, 1 or 2% typically. And so you're not sacrificing much of the capacity of the overall system in order to get to allow this learning to occur. And so then you still have that 98%+ of the capacity available just in case a backup event happens right when, even when you're right in the middle of a learning pulse. This shows some experimental data that we captured using a lithium ion cell, where we cycled it periodically and then captured some learning pulses as it was aging. And you can see the R cell, as the capacity slowly faded and then dropped off quite quickly here, the R cell measurements that were captured showed a slight increase and then quite a dramatic increase at this point. We realized, unfortunately, that we were not taking readings as often as we should have. We really wanted a lot more resolution right in this area. So we did the experiment again using a different cell, again still lithium ion, and you can see here we got a lot more resolution on our measurements, and so you can see the capacity as we measured it from cycling, it was slowly fading and then began to accelerate the decrease here toward the end. And then you can see the R cell values that we measured were steadily increasing here and picking up in slope here as the capacity also dropped off at a faster rate.